Hey everyone, welcome back. Meeting the rapidly rising energy demand with mostly or solely renewable energies is a huge challenge. So next to stimulating renewable energy uptake and reducing CO2 emissions that we talked about before, we will also have to reduce our overall energy consumption. So this video is about improving energy efficiency, which is an effective way to do this without sacrificing our living standards or our development goals. So let's define this. We define energy efficiency improvements as a reduction of energy used per unit of energy services delivered. For example, this could be a reduction in energy used to provide lighting to an office building. And the energy service doesn't change here, we just use less energy to provide it. A different way of looking at it would be that you can deliver more services with the same amount of energy. Another example, the improved efficiency of solar panels would result in more electricity produced per unit of incoming sunlight. So it's about making better use of the energy that we have. So how can we actually achieve this? Well, before we dive into efficiency policies, let's just take one step back and first get a broader picture of the opportunities that we have. Here, in this famous picture, we see the greenhouse gas abatement cost curve. That's a mouthful, developed by McKinsey. And it ranks relevant options to reduce emissions, from the lowest to the highest associated cost. The width of the bars are the abatement potential. So the wider the bar, the more CO2 that could be avoided. As you might have noticed, some of these options are covered by the renewable energy and CO2 policies that we discussed in the other videos. For example, we see solar, we see wind, geothermal energy, and biofuels. But there are many more options, and a lot of them are actually not addressed by either the CO2 or the renewable energy policies. And many of these are actually related to improving the energy efficiency. Switching incandescent light bulbs to LEDs, for instance, or improving insulation in buildings, and using more efficient appliances. And actually, you might have noticed something else. Why, here on the left side, do the options show negative cost? Well, that means you would save money by implementing these options. And LEDs, for instance, they are more expensive than incandescent light bulbs, but the resulting savings in energy costs are higher than this upfront investment. Well, in other words, you save money by reducing your emissions, but because you lower your energy bill. Well, that does sound like a good deal. And it is. But still, these options are on this curve. So think about it. Why aren't they realized? Why are they still on the curve? Well, this abatement curve only reflects the financial aspects of realizing greenhouse gas abatement. Is that the whole story? Let's just look at an example. Let's look at the introduction of electric cars. What are the barriers needed to make them the standard vehicle that we see in the streets? Let's just start by the costs. Electric cars are expensive, both for users and producers. And car developers actually need to take risks in developing them, hoping that the users are, down the line, willing and able to spend more than on a conventional car. But it's not only cost, there's more. Just think of all the other actors involved. There's more than the drivers, there's more than these car manufacturers. For electric vehicles to work, you need a large-scale rollout of a charging infrastructure. And how is that going to be coordinated? Think of the parking garages, the employees, governments, electricity network operators. They all need to coordinate the development of such an infrastructure. And I think you can imagine that it is quite a challenge. But it's more than this. There's more. If you think of all the physical interdependencies that matter here. So let's assume that you have the charging infrastructure in place. You also need to ensure that the capacity of the electricity grid is sufficient. That there is enough electricity generated when it is used. Parking spaces need to be adapted. And this may even temporarily disturb the traffic or disfavor conventional cars because they might not be able to park there. Okay, there's still more. So the last category, drivers need to adjust their driving behavior. They need to charge regularly and they need to plan their trips around the available charging infrastructure. And the question is, are they willing to do so? Okay, so one thing is clear. There are many reasons why some of these innovations don't just drive themselves. And putting an electric car on the street alone won't make it running. So barriers for all the energy efficiency improvement can be grouped, as we just did for the electric car. And this shows why a push or pull is needed here and there, and that is where the policies come into play. Okay, so, which ones of the policies could we use to approach these barriers and improve energy efficiency? Well, there's so many different policies, as there are barriers, to promote energy efficiency that it's so easy to get lost. Think about petrol taxes, energy labels. There's such a wide variety. I think most of the policies out there can be assigned to one of these five categories. And I hope this overview helps. So start with financial instruments, information instruments. You can think of regulation, procedural instruments, and voluntary instruments. Let's just explain it with a few examples. Let's start with the financial instruments. They're quite well known, and as the name suggests, they are mainly to overcome financial barriers. Think of tax benefits, such as the Dutch government offered buyers of electric cars, or think of the subsidies for renewable energy technologies. Another example is the small grants for newly built energy-efficient houses that the German government made available to homeowners. The second category, information instruments, aim to increase awareness, especially among consumers. And they primarily tackle behavioral barriers. When it comes to energy efficiency, labels and certificates are quite common. Here in the European Union, producers of certain appliances, like washing machines or fridges, they are obliged to indicate their performance on such an energy label. But also in the construction sector, labeling is used more and more. This allows consumers to make a better informed buying decision. And in turn, producers actually develop more energy efficient products to accommodate for the consumer's wishes. Do you actually remember whether there was an energy label the last time that you purchased a TV or washing machine? And did you look at it? Did you take the information into account? Of course, I did, but yeah, that's maybe my thing, you know. If there are already good and affordable options to improve energy efficiency, then direct regulation can be an option. For instance, energy performance standards and efficiency requirements are quite common. These kind of instruments disallow the purchase or use of products performing worse than this particular standard. An example is the ban on incandescent light bulbs in the EU. And another is the introduction of environmental zones in many cities where only clean and efficient cars are allowed. Okay. The next category is procedural instruments, like mandatory audits or energy management protocols at companies. And they can be effective for things that companies normally just don't think about, just because it's not in their regular frame of mind. For instance, how many times do you think does a company look at their energy bills? This can help firms to keep track of their energy performance and to optimize the processes with regard to their energy efficiency. Lastly, voluntary instruments are a means of kind of self-regulation. Industries or companies that are not regulated yet can set themselves targets and guidelines for improved energy efficiency performance. This works well for sectors in which energy efficiency improvements do pay off, but it only does if all the competitors do it as well. An example is the paper industry, where they have their own covenants. Okay. While energy efficiency improvements bear great potential, there are quite a few challenges. And with so many barriers that need to be addressed, and so many different policy options, it's hard to get it right. But it doesn't make it does make understandable that there are so many policies out there. One of the challenges is that not all policies are compatible. Some might even be counteractive. Just to give an example, funds used to improve the efficiency of conventional cars could, for instance, be undoing the support that we give for developing electric cars. And as you've seen with the example of electric cars before, many barriers apply and they should be addressed together. If you don't, then the policies that were implemented can be ineffective that would waste what was spent on that policy, and it may lead to delays. Another issue is that not all industries can be easily regulated. The shipping, aircraft industry, for instance, they can hardly be regulated just because their activities are across borders. Okay, the fact that it's difficult to get the perfect set of energy efficiency policies in place is not a reason not to try. There are many examples where policies had larger effects than expected. They target a variety of barriers. There are more than only those affecting economic costs and benefits. So despite the challenges, energy efficiency improvements can greatly contribute. And think of energy savings, CO2 reductions, uptake of renewables, energy cost reductions, well, and even human health and the economy. I wish you all the best of success with the exercises.